Yeah.
I like how that
hey.
You like that?
Like the logo, it's like it comes like, you know?
Yeah, it kind of moves
in. You never
in.
Really notice it, you know?
It's like a
Wait,
gentle.
Wait, turn the subs on?
Oh, yes. Correct. Thank you,
we got
lovely wife.
Subs.
We're gonna make this broadcast a little bit more accessible. All right. Check. How are we doing? Check your Twitch, folks. I think we have figured out closed captioning.
Did it work?
Check out your Twitch stream. We're letting people get comfortable. We're letting people come in. Stay fun.
And
what's happening?
I don't know how to work my phone.
Sure you do. But if it's not working for some reason on Twitch, know that we're trying and we're trying to work out. So. We'll see. Captioning ends up. It looks like you can kind of see that there is a little icon, stream CC. I'm not sure. Does that provide captioning for our listeners? If you click that, maybe not. It's all good. It's really great to try out these things, and
that's interesting.
You know, we want to get there where we can make sure that no matter who you are, you can enjoy the broadcast each time we do it. So we have a great show for you. I'd like to welcome you all to the Tomorrow Show. It looks like it's working.
Oh, cool.
Hey.
So,
yeah.
Oh, yeah. There we go.
Well, okay. So.
So it's behind, of course, as live ones are. Yeah. So it'll show up as like a little purple caption,
yeah,
at least on your phone,
yeah,
at the bottom right hand side, and if you click that, it'll open up a little window and you'll be able to see it.
And you know, that's just one more way we can kind of continue to try and enhance what we're doing here at the Tomorrow Show. Just like the Tonight Show, just like the Today Show, we are designed to entertain, but we're also there's a bigger goal here, and that's supporting, talking about your mental health, being proactive with your mental health, and being a part of this community where we connect the dots, the Hope for Us Network, bring people together. So really happy to have you here, Kegley, Ben, AC's in that chat sounding off. We got some air horns, some bits cheering. I'm sure there'll be some subs and all that. So if you got friends on Twitch, tell them to come on over. Tell them to share the broadcast on their other socials. Let's have some fun. All right.
Coffee's good.
Coffee is always great. And if I come up in your business like this, that means I'm either messing with the closed captioning or we are checking on our show notes. So.
Show notes.
All right. So we got, what's the date? What's the date today?
The 27th?
That's right.
27th.
Well,
it's April.
I don't even know what the day is most of the time.
I know. It's kind of like...
back to StreamYards.
Things are flying by. Oh, yeah. Sorry. I was trying to split screen it. So, yeah, you know, we've got 2 weeks under our belt since the last show. How's it going? Lots happened. Time has been... super weird, right? Time's super weird. You got the fast time and the slow time kind of cooking on us.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. It's crazy. What's been getting you through the last couple weeks? Any excitement in your world, AC? I know we teased a little bit last time.
Oh, you know, just stuff. Awesome stuff. I got a dog.
Yeah. Yeah. You got a dog. You got a dog named Phoenix?
Yeah, I don't want to say anything last show. I don't like to talk about things. I don't like to jinx anything.
Yeah.
Like when I just recently got my new vehicle, I try not to talk about it because I didn't want to jinx it. I had already had bad luck.
Yeah.
So I got that, you know, got the dog, played South by Southwest last week. That was insane. It was a lot of fun. And
did you see any did you go see anybody?
I saw a couple bands. There's one band called Blushing out of I want to say Austin, Texas. It's a four piece. Lead singer, female plays bass. Yeah, lead singer plays bass, female, and then they got a guitar player.
Oh,
another
yeah.
female that shreds, and then rhythm section drummer and a bass player, both dudes, but four piece band, really good.
Cool.
Blushing.
Found them on TikTok like months ago and started following them on Instagram, and then it was like, I think it was like sitting in the airport waiting to fly out to Austin. And I was just scrolling Insta and they popped up and they're like, we're going to be here tomorrow. And I was like, oh,
nice.
I'm going.
I'm going to be there.
I'm doing this.
So got to check them out. Got to see an old friend from high school I haven't seen in like 25 years.
Nice.
So that was cool. And I went dancing.
Ooh, you did?
You're dancing the night away.
Nice. I don't ever go dancing.
It's kind of like perfect that you went dancing. You're talking about it because breakdancing later.
Yeah. Oh. It was fun.
Did you breakdance?
I did not breakdance.
You just did your normal moves?
I just danced my good old, you know, like 50 Cent would say, my good old two-step.
Your two-step.
you know?
Do you arms up or do you like keep your arms up?
It depends on the song.
Yeah.
You know? But
do you ever get the arms out like that? Do you
yes, do that? Yes, yeah. A lot.
Where's that Cheerio box?
Oh, the iced tea one? I put it by my backpack so I can take it to work.
I have to show you.
Please grab that. Yes.
Yeah. Good times.
What?
Did you dance like this, AC?
Yeah, were you dancing like that?
Probably at some point.
Why?
Look at him. He's like snapping. He's almost biting his lip.
Is he me? This is how I dance.
Yeah,
it's just horrible.
Iced tea does look like he's me dancing at a wedding in that picture. Sorry, Ice-T. Pretty cool, though.
I was killing it.
I bet you were. Hey, out in the chat, out in Twitch, and you all go to Austin? Did any of all of you experience any of that South by Southwest? So if you did, we'd love to hear about what kind of bands you saw, any shout-outs you want to give. If you haven't, AC, like, what was it like there? Is it like you go to a festival? Like, in some people's minds, it might be South by Southwest festival is like you go to a venue and you go watch a bunch of bands. Is it like that?
Yes, yes and no. So there's like this section of downtown Austin, Texas that they kind of shut down in a weird way.
Right.
And pretty much, you know, there's bars and clubs, you know, all along the streets. And so what it is like, you know, all up along down these streets in the downtown area are live shows happening. A lot of them are free. And then
That's
some
sweet.
Of them are not free. And you have to actually like pay to get in, or you have to actually have like an official South by Southwest badge, like to get into those things. And those badges, you know, are pretty expensive.
Yeah.
You know, so there's, you don't have to buy one of those badges, you know, to experience it, you know?
Yeah.
A lot of those badges are for like special performances or special like panel reads or things like that, you know? Like you can just like go to Austin, get a hotel room and just
and still walk see around. That's cool.
So, I mean, it was like the first day I was there. I was walking around with one of my bandmates and just popped into a bar. It was like 1 o'clock and saw a kid by himself doing an acoustic set. And there was no one in the bar, like three other people. And I saw a girl sitting at the bar. I'm like, do you know him? She was like, yeah, yeah, yeah. Mm. It's like, here's my card. I like him.
Oh, nice.
And the dude hit me up and like, we've been talking since. He's from Maryland. He's got like a side solo gig. He's got like his podcast that he's got going on.
Nice.
I think the group's called The Hollow Truth. But there's music everywhere. So I mean, if you ever get the time and it happens next year, you know, I would definitely say check it out because it's affordable.
Nice.
You can do it, and it's a lot of fun. And Austin's a cool city.
Yeah, we visited. Mm-hmm. And
yeah, I've been a couple times.
Cool stuff.
Yeah,
and I think when they say keep Austin weird, like, that's like the kind of weird that I am.
Oh, Austin's definitely weird. Definitely weird.
It's kind of an oasis too in an otherwise conservative state that is fucking around with a lot of strange and upsetting legislation. Yeah. So
it's kind of very small, slight blessing in disguise that, you know, a lot of the legislation happens in Austin.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Because the libs
will
go, like with this trans stuff, with all the trans bills, anti-trans bills, you know, there's probably a bigger population of trans individuals in Austin that are loud about it. And they, you know, go to the Capitol and there's been all these protests. So that's kind of like a, you know, if it was like the Capitol or, you know, where this where legislation was happening was like somewhere else in Texas.
Yeah. Sure.
You know, they have to travel. You know what I mean?
Yeah, definitely.
I don't know.
But it is kind of spread out, like as far as like
the
festival goes. It seems like that there's a lot of representation in the artists that are brought to that center, you know, of like cultural diversity and stuff in Texas. I mean, if you're gonna, you know, pick any city in Texas to experience a good cross section, a good intersectional kind of thing going on,
yeah,
it's Austin, and I'm sure that there was. During South by a lot of networking, a lot of connecting with those people that are doing activism or those people that are trying to speak to their experience through their art with music and stuff. So yeah, that's pretty cool that like there can be that positivity radiating out of that city for, was it like a week long or is it even more than that?
It was like a week or two or something like that.
Yeah.
So...
And you got to play outside. That's pretty cool.
I got to play outside.
They have so many. They have like so many cool like outdoor kind of stuff. You know, because they can be outdoor all the time.
Yeah, it was nice, and we had the perfect time too. It was like 7, so it wasn't like too hot. Like the sun had kind of gone down just like a little bit.
Yeah,
so it was just like. It was perfect.
Cool.
That's nice. That's nice. Yeah. 2 weeks is what Skramsky says. I think it's pretty cool that, you know, people can have a certain idea in their head and they get there and it's like Scott said, vendors everywhere. They take over the downtown.
Yeah.
And you get to kind of just be immersed in a largely like, outdoor party. It's like the city becomes the venue.
Yeah,
it seems like
I had a lot of tacos.
It probably helps. Yeah. It probably helps any business down there to have all those people that are hungry, want some drinks, want to buy a shirt.
Yeah,
I bought a sweet shirt in Austin. I bought, oh, sweet. Yeah, look, check out that venue map.
Wow, yeah.
Yeah, so some of the stuff you got to hop in an Uber or whatever to get to, or
some you can walk to. I walked a lot.
I walked. These boots are made for walking.
Yeah, I walked a lot until I had to play. And when I had to play, that's when I got an Uber.
Yeah.
But it was cool.
Wicked. Cool, cool.
Lots of fun.
I bought a shirt. There's a little area of shopping in Austin where there's all these shops. And there's this Triple Z place. They've got all these. You see my Laser Cat shirt? It's got a little Laser Cat.
I'm sure I have, yeah.
Basically, they got like a bunch of awesome snap shirts that they definitely like thrifted.
They thrift them and then they embroider.
And then they got sick embroidery.
Yeah. So his cousin, your cousin, has the one that has Bigfoot.
He's got the Sasquatch, the same
Sasquatch. Yes.
Bigfoot, Sasquatch, whatever. Yeah. It looks like the Yeti Man.
Yeah.
The Yeti Man.
And it's like embroidered here and here on his shirt. Yeah. So years later, I'm in Austin. I go to this shop and I'm like, oh my God, there's that shirt. And then they have like a couple different styles where definitely like their embroidery machine or whatever is like set to do the Sasquatch or do the Laser Cat. So yeah. I got the Laser Cat.
But like the shirts are all different. Like all the shirts.
Yeah, you got to try them on. They're like cut differently and
yeah, different Western, makers. They're all different Western shirts.
And they got the snaps.
Yeah.
No, you got to try them.
Where you get bop. Pop that open like Superman.
Like you pop them open and there's like a strong wind fan coming at you.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
You stand in front of the fan.
And the shirt just goes.
Yeah.
That's right. Laser Cat is always the way to go, Clint McGivens.
I'm so into that.
Yeah, it's good. Just a little sweet little cat with lasers coming out of his eyes. It's a good shirt. Great shirt. And I contemplated buying some cowboy boots or a cowboy hat while we were down there, but didn't do it.
Yeah.
Didn't do it. I'm going to put my resources into
So you got back from South by Southwest, and then you went right and got your dog pretty much.
I landed, got my luggage and my gear, took the train home, dropped my stuff off, drove out to Andersonville, got the dog. landed in Chicago from Austin, Texas at 10 a.m. and had a dog by 1.
Woo!
This was not the first. Hey, buddy. Puppy, National Puppy Day.
He's really cute.
Phoenix is cute as hell.
That's the dude.
Hey, so did you get to meet him before the pickup?
I met him a week before. And so I was kind of stressing out because, you know, I met him. And I was like, yeah, I want the dog. Let's go. But then I was like, if they give me the dog like tomorrow or the next day or whenever.
Yeah, you're like, oh, God.
I was like, I got to find somebody to watch him now for like 2 days now while I'm gone. Like,
yeah.
So I was like, for a second, I was stressed and I was like, hey, I got some things I got to, I don't want to tell him like I was traveling. I don't want him to be like, oh, right off the bat,
right.
Bad parent. He's
right.
Traveling.
You're gone, done.
You know? Yeah. It's like, it's just the timing, you know?
Yeah. You're like, this doesn't happen.
So I'm just like, hey, everything's great. I got some things I need to take care of. I can take him next week, Sunday.
Nice.
Da-da-da.
Yeah.
And I'm just waiting and waiting. I had sent them that email the next day after we met and didn't hear anything. And as my friend Kelly, shout out to my friend Kelly. She's awesome.
Kelly.
As she's driving me to Midway to get on my flight to Austin, they hit me up and they're like, all right, it's approved. You're good to go. Here's the links for this. Here's that, you know? And I'm just like, cool. I have to check my gear that I've on the flight. And I'm buying pet insurance right now. As I'm okay, here we go. So, like, the whole time, also in Austin, just trying not to freak out.
Yeah.
Like, cool. I'm playing an awesome show. This is awesome. I'm not at home. I'm getting a dog as soon as I get home. Yeah. Oh shit, what am I doing?
Dude, so I have like, so many feelings all at once.
So like, it's been a pretty couple,
it's a lot.
It was like a cyclone, and then you got to have a few days adjusting with the dog and getting to know him.
Yeah, it just so happened that I took a bunch of time off too because I was spending time with family, like my baby brother for his birthday.
Nice.
And so I had time off. So I was like, well, I'm going to hang out with my daughter.
Yeah.
Shit, everything.
Shout out to Fosters for giving dogs a loving home until they can find their forever home. Yeah. A lot of great organizations out there that do this work. We found ours through an organization like that. Almost Home Foundation was, we went through Pet Finder, but then we found a dog. We were like, oh man. And we were in a similar situation because we had to go to Mexico for a friend's wedding, like a destination wedding.
Yeah.
We're like, well, shit, like what if we miss out on this dog?
Yeah.
But it's the timing, man. Like it's somehow those animals find you and it's like, that's the match. Cause it just so happened. Minnie was not named Minnie yet, obviously. Dee Dee was what she was being called by the foster.
Sure.
And was cool just chilling there for until this adoption event that they had at PetSmart. And we drove out there. We were all super nervous because we were like, somebody's gonna get her before us, you know. So we got there early and we scooped her up and she came home with us. And with your situation, you went through like a local Almost Home or no, Almost Home.
Ours is called Almost Home.
I went through one tail at a time.
That's right. And I drive past it on the way to work a lot.
Great staff, great people.
Yeah.
Shout out to Kara, the foster.
Cool.
Super, super nice. Did a great job with the dog. I felt that's bad wicked. For her because she had the dog and then...
It's got to be tough.
Somebody adopted...
You bond with it.
Yeah, somebody adopted the dog out. And things didn't work out.
Yeah.
And return the dog to one tail at a time, I guess, or whatever, like a month and a half later or something. And so she got the dog back. And then I came along like a month and a half after that. So I felt kind of bad, you know. It's like, you know.
She had other dogs probably, though. Right?
No, this is the only one.
She was just kind of, okay, gotcha.
Yeah.
And so I was like,
yeah.
Sorry. Like, if you're ever in Logan,
no, it's gotta be a difficult thing to do when you develop a little relationship and then you gotta part with it. Yeah, there you go. You can
they're
bunnies
great.
Too, I guess.
Yeah,
you can cast dogs and bunnies.
They're great because they do sponsored adoptions.
Yeah,
they do training. Like they'll get your dog. They'll like help you get training if you need it.
A cool organization.
And what Aaron is saying, you know, as far as like, you know, the sponsorship of the dogs, like my dog Phoenix was sponsored. Everything was covered. So there were no adoption fees. I didn't have to pay for the dog to get spayed or neutered or microchipped or any of that. They really go all out.
Just want these guys to have
look at all
homes.
These faces. Look at all these noses.
And they, you know, a lot of these dogs and cats, you know, they'll tell you specifically like what, you know, living situations they're good with. If they're good with other animals, if they're good with people, if they're good with elevators. That blew my mind. I was like, really, that's a thing, you know? So definitely check them out. They're you know, if you're looking for a new pet, a cat, a dog, like
I
highly recommend them for sure.
Yeah, I mean,
a lot of bunnies.
I had no idea that they did bunnies.
Yeah, it's crazy.
That's that floppy,
that's
ears
so
look.
Cute. And if you're not somebody that's been a pet person and you wanted to give it a try, I'm sure they're looking for foster families all the time too. So it takes a village, and this is not easy work, I'm sure, to create a whole like kind of dossier on Vanessa the bunny.
Oh.
Look at her eating her greens. Oh my goodness. But yeah, it's there's like bonded pairs. There's all sorts of factors to take into account when you're, I mean, these are living, breathing, that they're the closest thing to us as far as like, you know, the domestication.
Yeah. Watch, we'll tune in 2 weeks for the next show and Aaron will be on the couch with the bunny.
Yeah. we don't have a bunny yet. We have many other animals and we're done with that rescue.
Had to get it.
Vanessa or whatever.
Vanessa the bunny. Yeah, it's cool. They bring a certain element to your life that if you're like me, and you get stuck in your head sometimes, and that can be kind of a bad place to hang out. The pets in my life, this kitty, this puppy, they definitely draw me out of my, you know, unhappy place sometimes. And I got to take care of them. I got to feed them. I got to take them out every once in a while. I got to sometimes just sit there and appreciate them too, that they're like this little small miracle, like with these little tiny, tiny, like, you know, little fingers almost, you know,
these little things,
they're like little babies. Or like watching them get big, like Gandalf, our cat, was basically a little puffball that I could hold like this. And now he's just like two arms full. And that's amazing. I mean, it's probably similar when you have children and you watch them grow. But if you're an animal lover, one tail at a time is one of the best out there. And I will say that I will never forget that I had an idea when I used to work for Hope for the Day. I did a like a self-care fair at Chop Shop here in Chicago. And it wasn't your typical mental health fair where we just had mental health services represented at like the vendors that were there kind of set up with their tables. We had Marwin Arts, which is a great place that like will give your kids art classes and stuff like that. If you know, God forbid they've been at a school that's had all of that kind of arts funding taken. There's obviously the YMCA that, and Big Brothers, Big Sisters that give kids like an opportunity for mentorship, even in a casual sense, just like somebody to look up to, someone to bond with, someone to learn from, other than just their parents, especially if maybe they don't have like some parents.
Yeah.
So, but One Tail at a Time was so dope because they brought out a little rescue. And they let kids come pet it and like, you know, and they told families about, hey, you know, this is another way that you can support your own family, your whole family's mental health, not just your kid, not just your parent. And I think our guest later, Ryan, is going to probably be able to shed some light on how amazing animals have been for him and his family, too. So. Shout out to the animals, yeah. Right?
They one time I was at like an art fair, inside Emporium, and One Tail at a Time was there with this big like white pit bull who was so sweet, he just had the biggest head, and he was so that. Cute. Yeah. And I think that's so great.
It's cool to see that they aren't concerned at all about popping up wherever the hell they can,
yeah,
because they know they got all these lovable animals that need homes.
Yeah, I think it really works.
Yeah, they get out there, they roll up the sleeve, they're in the community. And shout out to anybody that volunteers at any of the shelters here in the city or anywhere else, because that's a tough job too. And I know that I love animals more than anything, so it's really great to see that compassion. Yeah. So, congratulations, my man.
Yeah.
Phoenix is awesome.
Loves you so much.
You get to see Phoenix in the next segment of Theory and Beats on the show today, which, you know, we're continuing that 5-part series, thanks to AC, exploring the elements of hip hop. Today we'll be breakdancing. And we're going to kind of keep it streamlined today so we have ample time to talk to our guest, who, as I mentioned before, is a parent, a gamer, just a great dude that I know from working both at Hope for the Day and even before that. And it's so cool that we get to continue having some conversations on Hope for Us Network and catch up a little bit. It's going to be really neat. I just want to, before we move on to Theory and Beats, I just want to say thanks to everybody that's commenting about the closed captioning.
Yeah.
I'm glad it worked. I'm glad we gave it a try, and I can't take any credit.
Yeah.
Scott.
Yeah. Scott, thank you.
The man. Good job, man.
Yeah, I mean, I have a couple of friends who use that stuff consistently, so it's important, you know.
And before we go on to Theory and Beats 2, I think it behooves me to mention a an Oscar-nominated short film that you inspired us to watch.
Yeah. Well, that's like as far as I know, there's two nominees that are about like the deaf community.
Mm-hmm.
CODA.
Yeah. Yeah, Children of Deaf Adults.
Yeah.
CODA.
And then
is an acronym for Children of Deaf Adults.
Yeah. And then this one that we saw.
Yeah, Netflix had put together a little Oscar nominee group that she stumbled upon while we were just kind of winding down and watching some TV.
Yeah.
And it was a film called Audible, 50 minutes long. It's in that short film category where I guess there's some, it's a very specific length that has to be.
Mm-hmm.
And so the cutting, like the way they cut through it, it's got like a really great pace to it. You're moving through a pretty deep story.
Yeah.
In kind of like a concentration of these visuals and all this really cool audio editing, because it's portraying a football team of deaf.
Yeah, so there's a high school.
Deaf high school. Maryland School for the Deaf.
Yeah, it's the Maryland School for the Deaf, and they
this movie,
I guess, have one of the best high school football teams in the country, which, you know, they talk about a lot, having to prove
they had won like 40 something games in a row. Yeah. So like over multiple seasons they had been undefeated,
and the kids were talking about how they have to constantly prove everybody wrong, that yeah. That they can do just the same as any other football team,
right,
even though that they're deaf. So that was really cool.
The coaches, but then too.
The coaches also, yeah.
Signing.
Right. Well, yeah. I think
they it's amazing.
Would have to be. Yeah. But then there's also a whole mental health aspect to it.
Yeah. The through line is losing a member of their community.
Yeah. So there was a kid who completed suicide, and, they, you know, kind of do it all for him. So it was really emotional, and but like really beautiful.
It just gives you such a great like look into the deaf community too, because the way they portray it, like they talk about how they can't really hear, and it's different for everybody, but like they can't hear music the same. And like
even if they have a
cochlear implant, and they're listening to music through their headphones or whatever, they can hear that bass and that vibration. But this individual that's like the main focus of the story, he can't hear lyrics.
Like he doesn't his brain
never learned like oral language,
right?
Or
so
language,
he lost his hearing as a 2 or 3 year old.
Yeah, he got like.
So if you think about
scary,
it,
right?
Yeah, if you think about it, you wouldn't have learned very much language, and he has gone most of his life without. Well, I shouldn't say language, without speaking.
Yeah, it's a different kind of language, is it?
Yeah,
yeah.
So his brain like doesn't understand the word, like it doesn't have meaning, right? Like it's just if you think about it, it would just be like a sound. So yeah, so he was like, I listen to, the only time I really turn my cochlear implant on is when I'm listening to music, and I listen to it for the bass and the sounds of it, not the lyrics, he said. Which was just like, oh, really cool. It gets you thinking if you're a person who hears, who's hearing.
Yeah. And there's this other component of it where there's cheerleader, like a cheerleading squad, pom squad for this school for the deaf, and the drum is like the most important part of it, because there's just somebody that beats the drum, so that they're all doing their moves all synchronized, even though they can't necessarily, you know, hear a song that they're doing it along to. They're hearing that pulse of the drum being played. It's so dope. It's so awesome. So there was some friends, and one of them went, he went to a hearing school and lost that kind of community component, and life was extra cruel, as it sometimes is for people in marginalized communities.
He was being bullied for being deaf and gay, and mm-hmm. That's what happened.
extremely, really sad. Extremely intentional and intersectional film. And I learned a lot and was super moved. So check that out. And there's like a lot of other.
Yeah. So that's documentary short subjects.
Yeah.
Well, not animated.
Or sorry. Yeah. There's other shorts.
Documentary short subject. A few, four of them, I think, or three of them at least. One, two, three of them are on Netflix.
Cool.
So that's pretty neat, yeah. And then
the other ones look equally intense and equally and then
they
compelling.
Have they have a short animated, a couple short animated on Netflix too.
Isn't there that one short animated you were talking about that's like qualifying in multiple categories?
That's not short, that's long.
Oh, so, that's a full feature?
Yeah. So Flea is a Danish film that Flea. Is nominated for
Flea.
Animated International.
Flea like I'm leaving, right?
Yes.
Like I'm running away.
Yeah, it's about an I believe it's about like an Afghan refuge.
Yeah.
Refugee family. But yeah, so international film, animated film, and documentary. Which is really cool and different. Like the thing.
That is, that they mashed all those.
Yeah. So I really want to see that. That's on like a lot of, that's available on a lot of stuff to watch.
Cool.
But yeah.
So there's your Oscar tips.
Yeah, so the Oscars are tonight. You know, say what you will, they're probably, you know, all awards stuff is really pretty problematic, I would say, arguably. I just have watched them with my parents since I was 8 or something. So I just like ask for work off. Like I've never missed one. It's just something I really love. So that'll be fun.
Do you have any Oscar party traditions, like a certain food you prepare?
Not too much. Nothing like, you know, really just, you know, a nice beverage and some nice finger foods or something. Pizza.
Nice.
Or we might have to go get some finger foods.
Finger food time. Do you have any award shows that you like to watch? Like, you know,
I watch the Grammys, and that's why I got really confused, because I know there was like a certain thing with the,
you know,
ceremony.
People just,
you know, a host and an artist, or there was a thing. I don't want to say too much. And so for some reason I was like, wait, is it the Grammys? Because
because that's next week.
Yeah, and see, and I don't.
Grammys is the week after the Oscars. Is that always happen?
No, usually.
But they're usually kind of around the same time.
Yeah, the Oscars are late this year. But
so like my whole time of whatnot of shows is just thrown off.
Totally.
But like,
yeah.
I'll watch the Grammys and then the Oscars after that. Back in the day, I used to love the MTV Video Music Awards.
Oh yeah, the Spaceman.
That was my thing back in
the day.
Those
used to be great, dude.
I don't know how they are now.
I don't know either.
They're horrible. Are we showing our age?
And I'm trying to be nice about it.
Yeah.
But like I feel like after around 2005,
VMAs.
You know, after around 2005, they started getting weird. And the last two VMAs, just for the fun of it, I was like, you know what? I'm just gonna see what is popping, because they don't play music videos anymore.
Yeah, it's like kind of weird. Like, how are you gonna have a video music awards without playing music videos on your channel?
Even the MTV stations, they say they play music videos, like MTV Ocho or whatever they have.
Yo, Joe.
They still don't play music videos. So
I
like,
know. You're like, why?
You know, so like, I like, for example, the one that they just had, I checked it out and I turned it on. And I was like, I know I'm old, but I'm like looking at these artists and I'm like, I've never heard of you.
Yeah.
And I listen to a lot of music. And then when I go and look them up and I'm just like, you will not be here in 5 weeks, months,
not
years.
Not even.
Like,
yeah.
It's just so funny. I just like, it just doesn't feel like there's that substance anymore.
Sure.
But back in the day, the MTV Video Awards, that's where it's at. And even the categories now are like so different and like
yeah,
totally irrelevant to the whole concept of the show,
sure,
and what it is. So it's like, you know, if you're bored, go look it up. Go look it up. Go look up like MTV VMAs from like 95, 2000,
yeah,
2005. 2000. Like, just go look every 5 years and see how weird it gets. Mm. I think the only artist that I might have recognized was maybe like Bruno Mars.
Yeah.
Or something.
Sure.
You that know?
Makes sense.
Shut up.
I bet you they'll be popping up. Him and Anderson .Paak, they'll be on the next one. Maybe. If they weren't on the last one with their Silk Sonic stuff.
Yeah. I just, you know, to touch on this, Oscar's So White hashtag from years ago.
Sure.
I just found out that Halle Berry is still the only Black woman to ever win Best Actress. Still.
Wow.
She was the first. She was the first.
When did she win?
Angela Bassett?
She was the first and the last.
Come on, Academy.
Nominees, yes. Lots of nominees. But like...
Like no Angela Bassett.
The first and the last to ever win Best Actress.
Whitney never got one for Bodyguard?
She did act her ass off in that.
I do love that movie.
How did she... See...
I don't know if she was nominated.
She may have gotten an Oscar for like...
Was she
song.
Nominated?
I know she got Grammy.
Yeah. Oh yeah, they wouldn't give it.
And I know she got something for the song. Wow, that's unbelievable.
I know. I was like, that sucks.
Do better.
Do better.
Yeah.
Well, yeah. You got anything else to add about the Oscars before we get into theory and beats?
I don't think so. All Not right. really right now. Yeah.
Cool. You ready?
I think so.
So this is the third installment.
This might be the shortest one too.
Yeah, and there's a little bit of context given from the previous segments because they connect and are like totally intertwined. You'll hear AC talk about that a little bit more as far as like this hip hop culture that is historical, and you need to be aware of it because it has spread into all genres. It has spread into all facets of life. It's important to know where things come from. So,
yeah,
I think you did a great job, and you're going to also get to meet Phoenix for the first time. So
just so people know, she was never nominated. Whitney Houston was never nominated for an Oscar, but she did have some Emmy nominations. And
Emmys.
Which is acting. So she won 2 Emmys out of 3 nominations. So many AMAs.
Was Whitney in a lot of stuff? She was just in Bodyguard, right?
No, she was in Bodyguard. She was in Waiting to Exhale.
Oh, she was in Waiting to Exhale?
Huge. Yo, not only was that a huge movie, that soundtrack was insane too.
What Luther Vandross, right?
That shoot song or whatever she had.
Oh, I want to watch that.
You know,
again.
Like that was a great movie.
All right.
Yeah.
So
yeah, there'll
be a couple other things that
man.
That we might need to research a little bit after this breakdancing episode as well. So,
yeah.
Cause there's some stuff. So stay tuned, really, key up your ears on this one. There's a lot to learn, in this next installment of Theory and Beats. I'm going to cut the subtitles just for this one. We have another enhancement we'll be adding for next episode where the pre-recorded content we'll also have subtitles, so you can keep following around. Let me cut these closed captions for just a second. And Scott, take us away to the Beat Lab.
On the previous Theory and Beats.
I'm AC. Thought it'd be kind of fun to do something a little different. The elements of hip hop.
Something might be up with that video. Did something happen to that video?
This is on my computer. It looks like it's all right on the beginning there. Yeah. Dang.
Uh-oh.
Is it okay, Scott? What's going on?
On the previous Theory in Beats.
I mean, see, thought it'd be kind of fun to do something a little different. The elements of hip-hop. MCing, DJing, breakdancing, graffiti, and that fifth element is beatboxing. Those five elements are very instrumental and very important. Those five elements, we're going to break it down. We're going to do a different element to the next five shows. For this one, we're going to start off with DJing.
Oh boy.
DJ Red Alert, Kid Capri, Grandmaster Flash, Afrika Bambaataa, Kool Herc. Theory in Beats. Theory in Beats. This is going to be the second part. The elements of hip-hop. Beatboxing, it's like a vocal instrument. You're pretty much just making a beat with your mouth. You know, a lot of beatboxing, you know, is used to emulate, you know, old drum machines, you know, those old Roland drum machines that they had like way back in the day. You know, if you didn't have one, you know, you would try, you know, and make up your own beat. You know, in that circle, having fun, you just freestyling like, yo, kick a beat. Dougie Fresh, you know, they call him the human beatbox. You went from Dougie Fresh all the way to Razzell, who used to be part of the Roots back in the day.
Like, to make a crowd move like that, just
probably one of the greatest songs of all time using vocal instruments, Bobby McFerrin, Don't Worry, Be Happy. That song was huge. That's a vocal instrument. That's like beatboxing. Everything that you hear on that track, that's all him making that sound with his mouth. I love it.
Hell yeah, man. I didn't know that you can do it a little bit.
In my younger days.
Beatboxed in a while?
I did this morning when I had some coffee. I was like, I wonder if I could do it if I had to. And I was like, okay, that's good enough. We've still got graffiti, breaking. I've also got MCing. I'm just telling you now, you will not see me doing any graffiti. You will not be seeing me do any backspins. I could not do either one of those two. But it'll be fun. We'll keep talking. It'll be cool. Fun. What's up? This is it's AC hanging out with my new friend, Phoenix. And we are here tomorrow show. And today we're going to be talking about one of the five elements of hip hop. We've already talked about DJing. We talked about beatboxing. Today I'm just going to talk a little bit about breakdancing. Breakdancing is one of those elements. It's something that I could never do, and I'm not being like, oh, I could never do that. And then, like, you see me, like, you know, a couple weeks later busting out backspins and headspins. Like, I can't. But it's like street dancing, pretty much. And it's huge. Like, it's very huge underground. It's not as big.
that I know of now is like it used to be, like say like from the 80s to like probably I'd say like mid 90s, late 90s. But back then it was huge. I remember growing up, coming up in like the Lansing area, and there were definitely like b-boy crews, like break dancers. They had them in like Ann Arbor, you know, East Lansing, Lansing, certain parts of Detroit, you know. Probably the biggest name as far as breakdancers go that I know of that I always knew about was this dude named Crazy Legs. And he was just in everything. Like, he was in everybody's hip hop videos. He was just, he was all over the place. He actually did a cameo in the track that you're hearing behind me, Erykah Badu's Ode to Hip Hop. He does a cameo in that, and that's in that video, which is pretty cool. He also does some, he also does some like other work that he's, you know, he's been in movies, commercials, things of that nature. There's a clip in Flashdance, if you look real close at the very end of the dance in Flashdance, you'll notice that the girl that's doing all the like acrobatics and whatnot, at the very end she does some breakdancing stuff, and it's actually him. And we'll pull up, you know, the clip of it, and you know, we'll share links with you. But like, yeah, and that was like huge back then. He definitely retired from breakdancing b-boys, from like the Rocksteady crew, which he was a part of, like came up in the Bronx. And I think he retired in like 2016, maybe? I'm not sure, I'll have to check that. But I know he was also like, had something to do with like the Smithsonian, like street dancing. There's something in there from that. But he's like, you know, when it comes to like breakdancing, like in hip hop, like, he's huge. Like, he was a big deal to breakdancing. Kind of wish more people did it. You don't see it that much anymore. But, yeah, Crazy Legs. He's insane. The clip in Flashdance that I was talking about where he's in.
Fucking Flashdance.
So here it comes. That's him.
Ah, that's Crazy Legs.
That's Crazy Legs. Oh, you would know it, never know it. They just they flop it and then they.
And that's back to the lady.
Yeah. So we'll show you one more time.
You know, I've never seen Flashdance.
It's a great movie. Here it is.
So here it goes. There's the switch. They just wigged him up, put a leotard on him.
Cut. Put the girl back in, like it never happened.
That's so fun. That's a good little tidbit.
Richard Crazy Legs Cologne on the famous Rocksteady crew is calling it quits, but his last battle is more celebratory for what
he's been
doing hip hop for over 3 decades.
Whoa. He's like the Michael Jordan of breakdancing.
100%.
The Tony Hawk.
He is the dude, man.
It was 1979 when Legs became a member of the hip hop group Rocksteady Crew.
Rocksteady Crew.
He's been breaking around the world and has appeared in national commercials and films like Flashdance and Beat Street. He's the crew's president and longest standing member.
Man, the upper body strength these dudes have.
Now, it's the day of his last battle. There are a number of dancers who feel honored by the chance to compete with a man they consider to be a legend.
We have that opportunity to kind of like, you know, celebrate that moment with them. I can't ask for anything better than that.
For this to be his final battle and for him to actually want me, to be here. It's really inspiring and it's an honor.
El Niño. Oh, look at that little kid. Yeah, man. That's cool. Look at him go. I bet little kids are awesome at breaking.
My ability to teach, and that's the beauty of the heart. If you're
gonna learn, it's pretty awesome. Learn it. We can share a link. They can check this out, too.
Sure, sure.
And then the other thing, I always love it when people put, like, artists in their videos, like cameos. Like, there's a Janet Jackson video. I want to say the song is, I think it's All Right. But she's got all sorts of like crazy like
cameos in it.
Cameos in it, like Cab Calloway's in it.
Oh, just, nice. Like,
all sorts of people.
Ha-da-ha-da-ha-da-ha.
And so Erykah Badu does that in this track, which is so good.
She's so interesting. Just her creativity is off the charts.
So here comes Crazy Legs.
Nice. The color.
Like hip hop royalty, man. You know?
Yeah. Well, it shows the intersection too with the MC side of things and just like the DJ beatboxing intersection. Look at Badu breaking, dude. Is that really her? Does she got some breakdancing moves?
You know, I don't know. It's Erykah Badu and she can,
it looks like her,
anything, so I don't know.
I mean, the backbends and stuff, maybe it's not her, but
I could see, I wouldn't doing put it past her.
Hell yeah, you know? Oh my god, what a cool lady. Oh damn.
We're gonna be talking about
MCs,
We're gonna talk about MC Light. I'm glad that she popped up in this video real quick.
It's like a preview of the MC installment.
We'll talk about that in a bit. But yeah, that's pretty much it, you know. And I mean, like anything, like breakdancing, it's one of the elements of hip hop. It's huge. It's important, you know. And get out there and check some stuff out. And when I say go check some stuff out, like, I don't mean necessarily like go to the internet and look around, because sure, you can do that. Why not? Go for it. You'll find some stuff. But like, hit the libraries. You can find some cool stuff that they talk about, like old school DJing and break dancing, like back in the day, like in your libraries, like the life of hip hop in the Bronx. Like, it's all about that, you know, like, and that's another part, graffiti, that we'll be talking about on the next segment. But it's everywhere, you know? And if you listen to the records, you know, there's breakdancing, like, MCs talk about that. If you see the music videos, like the old school music videos used to have dudes like breakdancing. And previous, you know, episodes I've talked about Scribble Jam. Go look up Scribble Jam. There's definitely breakdancing battles that you can check out, you know, on YouTube through Scribble Jam, like those old, you know, battles. So check it out. Shout out to breakdancers. Shout out to Crazy Legs. And shout out to yourselves for hanging out with us, hearing me talk about the elements of hip-hop. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. Yeah, yeah.
Phoenix! Phoenix!
It's so cool.
Dude. Oh, I gotta put subtitles back in. That, but man, I learn so much cool shit from you all the time.
No.
Oh, maybe I'd never click stop.
That's okay.
Well, whoopsie. I thought I did. That's all good. Okay. We're figuring it out. We're figuring out. You've all been cool about it, so. Yeah, so after I got done being given a master class, you only saw portions of it, obviously, because you really, on any of those elements, you could really go deep, 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 deep. And we've just been trying to keep them to like 15 minutes or so. If you want to see the full part one, part two, they're available on the archived episodes. And Scott dropped all the links for the YouTube and whatever else. Anywhere you can support the Hope for Us Network, please do so. If you're a TikToker, if you're a Instagrammer, if you're a YouTuber, or if you're a Twitcher, please just like spread that thing around. If you want to be on our Discord server, there's that too. So I never heard of Crazy Legs. Sorry, that sucks.
A lot of people haven't. It's okay.
Had you heard of Crazy Legs?
No.
So
yeah,
that's cool. And you know, like I'm just curious. I went and looked after you mentioned you dropped Smithsonian in passing, and it just turns out that there's like in the Smithsonian, there's a little bit of an exhibit. They've got his jacket. They've got like some of his other things.
Nice.
Because he was such an influential part of the culture.
Yeah.
And there's so much history that gets skipped when you're growing up in America. So much history, music history and otherwise. So just because you got taught some stuff when you were growing up, it doesn't mean it was comprehensive in any sort of way. Because it's so cool to learn about somebody as influential as this at the age of 39. But it's also stupid that it took this long for me to, you know, really learn this and soak this up. Because I'll never forget Crazy Legs because of the conversations we had while we were taping that. The videos we watched, which, you know, do your own searching too. You'll probably find some dope videos that we didn't even get to. So
there's a lot out there.
So cool. So cool. And then you also mentioned that Janet Jackson video. And then I went and looked for that. All Right is the tune.
Yeah.
Right.
Yep.
So I don't know. I don't know, Scott, if you could look up Janet Jackson All Right just for a second so you could see some of the like kind of screenshots. Cause the style of this music video, and it kind of like invokes this different era. And then Janet just had a bunch of swing legends. So swing music was huge earlier in the 1900s. You know, big orchestras playing that shit at the dance halls and stuff like that. And people,
big band type stuff.
Big band. Yeah, yeah. So
also
like,
important to you mentioned, culture.
Yeah, you mentioned Cab Calloway, who's in there. But then there's like all these other swing legends. And that's it's cool. Just really cool because Janet Jackson, well, from pop royalty, the Jackson family, Jackson 5, Michael Jackson, duh. So Rhythm Nation, just like so cool to see some of the people that like pop up in that video. But mostly I just want you to like see the style of this video.
It's so colorful.
And like, yeah, so there you go. And we could just kind of take a moment. And I know we've got our guests waiting backstage too. You got Cab Calloway, the Nicholas Brothers.
She also got that idea. That intro from Prince, Sign of the Times. Sorry.
Oh, okay. So yeah, yeah, like, so it's like a cinematic music video where you're
which
just
the
like
Jackson. The Jacksons did a lot.
But it's just like it sets this tone. It gives you this mood, and then like look at these outfits. Just look at those outfits. Like, look at those wide brim hats.
And the choreography is amazing. Like,
yeah. Cab Calloway, for you those that don't know, he's hidey.
Look at this.
Minnie the Moocher. Yeah, dude. Like,
that choreography is insane.
Like, yes. Yes. Look at them go. Look at them go.
Like the splits on a park bench?
Yeah, it's like this classic era of dance numbers that they're like, they've urbanized and they've made for them.
So the colors of this look kind of like old film movies,
yeah, like,
right? Like
Singing in the Rain and shit,
yeah.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
Like some of those Fred Astaire
absolutely
joints.
Absolutely, yeah.
Oh man, look at that.
Classic.
So yeah, you guys get the idea. So lots of cool things that just came up as we were talking about breakdancing.
Yeah.
Just goes to show you that they're not like separate silos. They're all
right.
Like this weave of like all the elements, like a tapestry, or like you know, it's just they're all woven together. It's kind of hard not to talk about the other elements when you're, you know, talking about one.
Yep.
So but
cool.
thanks for dropping that knowledge. It looks like Crazy Legs has made a impact that will carry on for generations. Do you remember when we went to the winter block party at the Metro?
Yeah.
And we got to see all those B-boy crews.
Yeah.
They were like the next generation. They were a bunch of young kids. So
yeah.
I know you said you're not sure if it's as big as it was in the 80s and 90s. Like in the 80s and 90s, people were out on the street corner doing it.
Yeah.
Right. And you don't see that as often nowadays.
And you know, and it's probably still out there. It's probably just a lot more underground than what it was back in the day.
Sure.
You know, like I'm sure like.
Well, people didn't have the internet sitting around on their couches looking at their phones. They'd go out on the street corner and throw down some cardboard.
Sure.
And, you know, bust some moves, eh?
Yeah. But so. I mean, I'm for sure there's definitely some like low key, like underground, like B-boy crews out there for sure.
Yeah. The Chicago Young Authors, CYA, they do like Louder Than a Bomb and all that stuff where it's like poetry slam, like kind of battles and stuff like that. They're real great at being like ambassadors for like the future cultures of, you know, Chicago youth anyways, and like giving them an opportunity to engage with that type of stuff, that type of culture. And that's how we kind of experienced it firsthand at the Metro here in Chicago for the winter block party. Hopefully Vocalo and WBEZ will be bringing that back, you know, in the coming year as things have gotten kind of more normal ish. So,
yeah.
But breakdancing is cool, man. And, you know, like just all things music. I could talk for hours with you. I can also do that with our guest, Ryan Shannon. So should we bring him on?
Yeah.
Let's bring him on. Let's bring on Ryan. Yeah. What's up, man?
What's up, guys?
How's it going?
Pretty good. Catching in on that piece there. I'm a huge Step Up fan. So like Alison Stoner and Adam Savary and Channing Tatum and all those dancers, man. I feel it, you know?
Yeah. Shout out to Alison Stoner.
Huge mental health advocate.
She is huge in that. For those of you that don't know who that is, Scott, I don't know if you have. No, we won't, because this is about you. Alison Stoner, she's the little girl that dances in those old Missy Elliott. She's like the little girl that's like doing those crazy dances. Go look her up on TikTok and Instagram.
Hell yeah.
She's like grown up and she's still dancing and doing her thing. And she's amazing.
Awesome. She is awesome.
Dude. Ryan, shout out to you for bringing her up, man.
Nice.
Absolutely. I follow her on TikTok. I still see what she does. She is getting more into like mental health and stuff too now.
Yeah.
She talks about being like a child star and how that affected her and being in those Missy Elliott videos. And did you see they did she did a redo as an adult of her dance in the Missy Elliott video with like another little girl.
That's awesome, man.
It's super cool.
That's like quite literally passing the torch to another generation.
Absolutely,
and being like,
absolutely.
Now it's your turn, you know. The control that dancers have over their bodies and then the discipline to rehearse that shit together to be all like fucking locked in together.
Well, it reminds me of those mind blowing we had last show.
Yeah, last show we did pull up Yara and Nora, Yara. There's three girls that we pulled up last week just as like something we were liking on the internet that was like positive and helping us get through to tomorrow.
And the same kind of stuff. They're all choreographed together, like just amazing.
They were so all cool. Rocking their Hilfiger stuff. Yeah. And it was a really cool. It just makes you smile. And that is important. That is some important shit.
I'm not coordinated enough to. I'm a tall, lanky white dude through and through, you know. I don't got no rhythm. I play the drums a little bit now, but I'm not dancing.
Yeah, man. You got multiple other talents and you have such a deep appreciation for music that it's not a surprise to me that you knew that Missy Elliott bit of trivia about Alison Stoner, who I'm going to definitely look up after the show today.
It's definitely the visualization in music is a big deal for me. Like when you hear a song, you hear it and in your mind you put like your own thoughts to what that song means to you, but then you get to kind of see what the artists and the filmmakers and the dancers also feel about that music, and it kind of starts altering. Sometimes though you see that oh man, I was right on. Like, that's exactly what this was supposed to be about, you know? And sometimes you're like, oh, they were thinking about it from this aspect, and it's cool to kind of broaden your mind a little bit and think about different perspectives that way, you know?
Mm. Yeah, man, absolutely. You've always been somebody that's always perked up my day by sending me a music video that you had come across, and like, you're like, oh damn, this is dope. And then you're like, I could just picture you sitting there and be like, oh, I should send this to Vinopal, or I should send this to Rick, or I should send, you know, like, let me send this to somebody that I know is going to actually look at it, watch it, and also probably get, you know, something out of it, even if it's a completely different thing that I got out of it compared to what you got out of it.
Absolutely. You know, my favorite band, 21 Pilots, and they're the stories and the lore and everything involved with these songs, but at the same time, the lyrics mean something completely different to me and the other person sitting next to me and sitting next to me. And that right there, that's huge. Like my son, my youngest son, he's really into 21 Pilots now, but I know he hasn't been through what I've been through. So the lyrics are meaning something different to him, and the beats are meaning something different, you know? And, it's just cool to kind of see that. And we talk about that, you know, like, hey, how does it make you feel? What are you thinking about when you're listening to this song? Why do you like this song? You know, that type of stuff. Nice. And it gets him at a young age, kind of train him to talk about feelings and how that's something that we should be able to do.
I'll snap for that shit.
Dudes aren't supposed to, you know, the old taboo, dudes aren't supposed to cry, that type of stuff.
Yeah.
I'm trying to raise a couple of dudes who know that that's okay. You can do that. You're totally allowed to do that. Let's do it. I do it. And so having him talk about music, I use it kind of as a tool as well, you know, like, hey, let's talk about how that makes you feel. Cause you can kind of see the emotion in them, you know?
And that'll give them something that they can always use to do that too.
100%.
Awesome.
They always say the most mind blowing shit too. Children that aren't like already like beat down by like all the additional shit that life can throw at you as an adult, you ask them something, a very honest question, and they can put it into words that you would have been very hard pressed to find yourself in a lot of cases. That's why I love teaching when I was working with special ed in elementary schools, because like just the way that kids answer questions, like, you know, it's not bullshit. It's they haven't developed a filter to act like they, you know, are like a certain way. At a certain point, they'll just like say exactly what's on their mind, and it's beautiful. Like, I've asked, I think I was actually watching a clip of a kid being asked about why they like a video game or something like that. And they're like, I don't know if it's verbatim this, but they're like, I get to control that world.
Yeah.
And I was like, damn, that's gnarly. That is like so like insightful that this is a comforting place for you because you're in control. It like kind of it shows that kids can understand that a lot of
100%.
The world is out of control for them, and that, you know, that natural ability to cope is pretty cool. I'm sure you've had some moments like that when you've asked, what's this song mean to you? Anything stick out for you? Top of your head?
I don't know. It's hard to get them talking a lot of the times. So they want to do their own thing, you know. But trying to push them along to talk about it. I watch my son mimic, my youngest son. He mimics the lead singer of 21 Pilots, and he'll wear what he's wearing and this and that. And trying to get him to like explain those feelings, like he'll use the word like, this one makes me feel a little gloomy. I feel a little gloomy from it. And I'm like, man, that's a word I haven't heard in a long time. Let me figure out what the word gloomy means, you know? And so like, I look into it and I start talking to him, you know, and I'm like, so what about it makes you feel gloomy? And he's trying to define, like the environment of the song, you know, like the soundscape of the song, but he doesn't know what that is or those words, you know? So he'll say things like the drums are slower in this one, or the pianos in this one, you can hear what's he call it? He calls reverb something goofy, something a little kid calls reverb. I don't remember, but he says those things. So it's cool to see it from his perspective. Whereas for like me, lyrics are huge, you know, like the musicianship and everything else. But if a song's got like good lyrics. For instance, I just I went back and went on like a day to remember binge the other day, and I pulled up the lyrics to some of these songs that I'd been singing for years, and I didn't realize how much, because they're screamy, so sometimes I can't decipher exactly what's being said, you know. And I went through, and one of these songs I've been playing for years that I just kind of in my car jam out to, you know, but I'm trying to sing the lyrics, but I don't know what they are. But I looked them up while I was listening the other night, and I was like, oh shit, that's what this song's about. Like, yo, this is why I attached to this song, even though my mind couldn't figure out what the words were. Like, it fit right into like my story, the repertoire of my music and the type of stuff that I listen to. And I was like, all right, this song has a whole different meaning, even though I've been listening to it for 6-7 years. It's pretty wild.
Yeah, I've done that too, where you like, you don't really know the words of a song. You love a song, but maybe you're like somebody that just hasn't been paying attention to the lyrics. You're more drawn to the guitar sounds or whatever. And then you actually look up the lyrics and you start reading them, and you're like, that's what they say. Holy shit. Like, and it can be like a shot in the heart, like in a good way, where you're like, damn, like now this song means even more to me. Like,
yep,
for sure.
100%.
You've made some young 21 Pilots fans out of your boys, huh?
I've at least one of them. My other son, my oldest son, Camden, Cam kind of walks his own path, which is cool to see. He's into skateboarding now. I mentioned this earlier. I skated when I was younger, nothing crazy, nothing good. I could kick flip, I could do things like that, you know. So let me backtrack a little bit about Cam here. So I did a lot of mental health work. I don't know if the people around here know exactly who I am, but so I'm a military veteran. I was wounded while active duty. I got retired. And man, I went through it. Things I did in the military, my body's just broken, and I didn't really have a path forward. My career was ending. So I just spiraled into the darkness, as we call it, you know. And I wrote a suicide letter. And my wife, or my partner, unknowingly stopped me from acting on it. And from that, like that's the point. Like that day is the day that everything kind of 180'd. And it didn't do it in like a full 180, you know, but gradually over time, I taught myself how to walk again. I had this terrible leg injury. I taught myself to run again. I found sports, like adaptive sports and stuff. And that culminated in me eventually winning track medals internationally. I was on SportsCenter a couple times. I used that against
Yeah, you were.
By the way. I did all this crazy stuff, and then I reached a point where I was like, all right, I'm done with this. I did it. I can move on to something else now, you know? And so I started doing mental health work for veterans and nonprofits and stuff with Mike and a couple other people. And then this is kind of where the story moves into to my oldest son, and where I was leading with this is that last year, my 8-year-old son had an undiagnosed mental health condition. We'd been trying to figure it out for 4 years. And as parents, that's very, very frustrating. You see your child suffering, but you don't. Doctors are supposed to be doctors. And this kind of goes through my story, too, is they just didn't know. They couldn't figure it out. Culminated in my 8-year-old child. He made a suicide plan. And it culminated at school. We got a call at school that he was acting out, and he said that he was going to kill himself with my weapon that I have here. So he said he was going to use my gun to kill himself. My gun's locked up. I don't want anybody. I absolutely believe if you have a weapon or something like that, you need to be safe about that. So that is locked up. He has no access to it. He can't access it. But even the idea that he said that and he had a plan, we got my son. He ended up in the emergency room for a couple days. This was peak COVID, so that made things even more difficult. But that night I went home. I called the police. I surrendered my weapon over to them for a time being, which is something you can do just so people know that. Like, if you have a legally owned firearm and you don't want that in your home anymore, you can surrender that to the police and then you can go get it back whenever you want to. And it's that easy. You just set up a time and do it. The policeman was very confused. He said, "This is the most proactive thing I've seen in 20 years. And I said, "That's, we're supposed to be responsible gun owners. Yo, like if we're going to have that right, we have to be responsible about it. This is that responsibility that should be occurring." And he's like, "Yep." And then I kind of freaked him out a little bit and he took the gun and he left. And I think 8 or 9 months later, I went and retrieved it. And that was it, because my son in the ER, they gave him an option. They said, "You can go home with your mom and dad, or we can go to," it was an institution. He could go inpatient and get the help he needed. And my son looked me in my face and he said, "I need help. I want to go get help." At 8 years old, my kid said this to me. And I was like, relieved, but at the same time, all the work we had done, Mike and all of us over there, we set that groundwork for him to know that that was okay. Like, you could ask that. As a parent, the hardest thing ever. I hated every single day that my son was in that institution. I'd much rather go through everything I ever went through again to never have to deal with that. But I knew it was helping. And then fast forward to now, we are at probably, we're almost at a year post that occurrence. Mm-hmm. And the dude's killing it. It's awesome. It's awesome to see. It wasn't an easy transition coming home, and he had to go to a new school and all this other stuff. But man, it was an adventure. And it's an adventure that taught me a lot about myself and my family and my son and resiliency in humans and all this crazy stuff, you know, because it's easy for me to get up there and tell him my story now and how I beat these things. But it's a whole different power when it's coming from an 8-year-old and a kid that just didn't understand why these things were going on and stuff. But let's move to what I was saying. He recently picked up skateboarding. All right. And like I said, I haven't skateboarded in 10 years. So I wanted to make sure that he was interested in it before we jumped head in, you know. And he came home every day for 2 weeks straight, and he got on this little skateboard that I bought for my bulldog, and he would just go out and skate on it, a little $20 Walmart longboard. And he said he wanted to do tricks, so I made a whole day out of it. We went to the mall, and we went to the skate shop, and we both built boards together, and he picked out his grip tape and his bearings and his wheels.
Oh, that's badass, dude.
And I picked out one, and I'm like, "Hey, if you're going to go out and destroy your body skateboarding like when I was young, I'm going to do it alongside you. But I'm pretty sure at this point I have more injuries in the 3 weeks we've been skating than he does. Because I got holes in my hand and bruises and my ACLs up. But I'm 35 years old." So I was like, "Hey, let's do it together." You know, it's pretty cool to see. So that's what we've been doing recently as a family, which is pretty cool. My wife, my Jasmine, she gets out there and she's trying to skate now too, and it's just a couple old dudes out there, or a couple old people out there skating around with their kids in the neighborhood.
That's awesome.
That's so cool. Is it close to your house?
The skate park is, we can skate from our house to the skate park, no problem. Like
less dude. Than
about 300, 400 yards or so.
Ryan, do you guys wear pads when you go out and skate?
I recommend that, but they are kids. My recommendations sometimes aren't fully, but eventually one day they're going to hit one and they're going to realize that dad was right. You know, that's something you get to see as a parent a lot too, is like, I told you, like I said, this was going to happen and then it happened. Yep. But he was, the other cool thing, and this goes into like skateboard culture, is that he was very nervous to go to the skate park. All the older kids and this and that, they're going to make fun of me and this and that. And me being a former skateboarder, you know, I was like, "Oh, you don't know skateboarders. Like if you go in and you like attempt and you even make that attempt and you're not a complete D-bag, I guess you could say, I was like, they're going to take you under the wing and then it's over. Like that's how it is." And sure enough, the first day I went there, there was a 28-year-old guy who'd been skating for like 15 years, and he was, you know, how every skate park has that guy, you know, that guy that just runs the skate park. He's the one everybody's chilling with and stuff. It was him. And he saw both of us or all of us out there skating, and he came over and started giving Cam some pointers and this and that. And I was like, yo, can you take him? Like, just teach him. Cause I just taught myself at a late age, you know. It'd be cool to see. And he's like, oh yeah, 100%. So him, and then Cam was just accepted right off the bat. Oh, so now you can go out there, and the OGs over there taking care of him and showing him some stuff, which is cool. Yeah, when Cam came back, he's like, he goes, they're a lot nicer than I thought they would be. And I'm like, those are skateboarders, man. That's how this works. Like, if you're one of them, you're one of them, and they'll protect you. And that's how this works, man.
So is that kind of how it was for you when you were younger?
Yeah. I can't ever say I ever ran into, like, any, like, bullies that were skateboarders. Like, everybody, like, just like Ryan said, like, very, like, will help you, you know, take you under, you know, their wing. And it's true. Like, every park has that dude. That's just, like, that dude. One of the parks back home in Michigan, I was that dude.
Nice.
Which is funny. And it's funny to get talked up by the little kids that can do more than you sometimes, you know? But, like, definitely, for sure. Like, even the Logan Square skate park that I try and go to by me, there's, like, the same, like, three dudes that I kind of see, like, time to time, like, over the years that are always there. I'm like, yeah.
Holding court.
Those are the dudes, man, you know? But, yeah, that's so awesome. That's so cool.
Well, it's getting warmer out, too, so you're going to give us some lessons, right? she got her board, like, last year.
Yeah. I've been wanting to learn how to – I woke up one day, and I was like, I've been telling myself my whole life that I can't stand on a skateboard. And why am I telling myself that? Like, sure I can. And so I'm still working on it. But yeah, now that it's getting warmer out again, I'll try some more.
It's that persistence. Oh, yeah. That was the big thing too, is I was telling them, like,
yeah,
if you're going to skate, you better be prepared to bleed. Cause that's how this works, man. Like, you're going to fall. And if you get back up, then that's going to, and he went out and he took his licks those first 2 weeks and came in with scraped knees. But he was proud of him because I kind of set that up, you know, like, he's like, oh, I'm all bleeding. And he's like, it hurts. And I'm like, you want to quit skating? He said, no. I'm like, all right. Like, it's clean you up and get you back out there and get going. And he's like, so yeah, he's got his little battle wounds now that he's pumped about. But
and those skaters out there, they'll, like, kind of pick up and they'll show him, like, how to fall too. Like, yep. So he's not like, he can avoid busting his ass too bad.
He's fearless now too. That's the other thing about him, is he's super fearless. And he went up, and the first day he saw the half pipe, and he's like, I'm gonna learn to drop in on that. And I'm like, you just bought this board yesterday. Like, I don't know if that. So I'm like, he's got to learn. Like, I'm not gonna let him just go up and try it. So I climb up there, and I'm holding his hands, and I'm like, all right, you got to lean forward and bend them knees. Trying to teach him to drop in, you know, and he goes and he falls, but I got a hold of him at least, so he's not bashing the back of his head on the coping and stuff, you know. And he's like, yeah, maybe I'm not ready for that. I'm like, you're definitely not ready to learn to drop in yet, but he can go up little ramps and down little ramps as long as there's not a huge drop in or anything, and he just goes and does it and falls over and over. And I'm like, this dude's a skateboarder. That's what he is. He figured it out. He found it.
That's awesome.
Cool. Yeah, man. So much of our lives is looking for a community, and when you find one like that, it's special. Did you guys watch any of the Olympics together? Did he get to see some of those youngsters shredding?
We watched a little bit of it. A lot of, like, the downhill skiing was really cool, and the big air and stuff. That he was really into that stuff, because
yeah,
I think he's got a little bit of that wild side to him, you know, where he's the one that's going to be broken bones and scraped knees. And then I think my other son is the social light of the crew, and
tight.
he's got a birthday party every weekend he's got to go to, and he's married now apparently.
He's married now. Cool.
Yeah, my 8-year-old came home the one day and said, "I have a wedding on Valentine's Day." I said, "What's that now?" He said, "I'm getting married." And I said, "Why wasn't I invited to your wedding?" You know, and
I contacted
his teacher and I was like, "Hey, just so you know, like on the low, if you could snag some pictures of this recess wedding that's about to occur with your students, that'd be sweet." And so, like they made a whole thing about it, and but, you know, just kind of embarrassing him. That's my job as a dad, you know, embarrass my kids a little bit. So, but he's also got he's his two best friend are his sons now, so he calls them his kids, and it's funny to watch it happen, you know, like it's innocent, there's nothing crazy going on there,
yeah,
you know, but
totally, yeah.
Like it is his wife, we'll call her his wife, she her mom will text my partner Jasmine and ask if they can play, so we'll drop them off and they'll do whatever it is they're being married at that age is. I don't know what that is, but it's funny to see.
That's cool. Yeah. I think it's probably been tremendously stressful. It's probably hard to be parents, you know, any given year, but to have kids in school, to have to navigate all the stuff you've had to navigate the past couple of years with COVID, must have been just like so intense, man. What are some of your other outlets? Obviously you love music. What are some of the other things that you've been doing?
It was rough for me when I was very involved in all of my mental health work and stuff. And when everything happened with my son, I looked at it as I was trying to save all these other people. And then in my own home, I felt like I was neglecting my kid, you know, like I was putting everything into this basket, but I wasn't really working here, you know? So I reevaluated, you know, I stopped. That's why I backed up. This is my first like back into it type of scenario, which feels really, really good, by the way. This is kind of what I love, you know?
Yeah,
and I finally felt like I was in a place, all of us were in this place where this was a good move to kind of get back into it, you know? But that was a big step for me personally to have to drop back and refocus and realign and stuff. And it was lonely. It was very lonely. I talked to people all the time, and then all of a sudden it was just kind of hanging out and doing my own thing and isolating a little bit and reevaluating. But I dumped a lot into my career, which was nice. I started teaching students in like India in other places in the world about what I do for a living, which isn't very exciting, but it pays the bills, you know?
Yeah.
And just kind of refocused on like my relationships here with my family. Like me and my wife's marriage is probably the strongest it's been in a while or in a long time. The kids finding stuff they want to do, but then I found things that I really loved, but I just wasn't doing. For instance, my New Year's resolution was I'm going to read 300 page books by the end of the year. So 30,000 pages or 100 books. And today I just finished another one. I'm at 22 books on the year and 9,500 pages. And I'm finding stuff that I really, really enjoy. I'll read a book, a 350, 400 page book in like 2 days, you know?
That's awesome.
So that's cool to do. We're building a home.
Yeah.
Crazy. So we'll have our first
dream house.
It is a dream house too. It's not cheap, by the way, just so you know. Homes are not cheap. But we'll have our first single family home, which is pretty sweet. And it's we can afford it. There's no like stress on the back end about being able to use it, you know, and I had to grow up a little bit, you know, not spend frivolously on this and that and save up and get a credit score where it needed to be because it wasn't there when I got discharged from the military. All that stuff affected, but now we're in this spot where like I can look at my life and I'm like, all this crazy stuff in the world's happening, but I feel good and I don't feel guilty about that, you know? I want to help as many people as possible and things like that. But I've also come to the realization is that if you don't help yourself, you can't help others. That's just how it is. If you're not in a good headspace, there's no way for you to help somebody else be in a good headspace. And getting myself to that headspace was difficult. This is the first time in my life, or in my adult life, I would say that there's nothing in the back of my head that's like, oh, I should be doing this, or I should be doing that, or I need to look for a better job, or I need to do, you know, that type of stuff. I'm just kind of floating through, you know, and it feels cool.
That's yeah. Awesome. That reminds me of the conversation we had the other day, because everybody's like always kind of in this headspace of I'll be happy when, like, they'll get to their goal that they've set for themselves, and rather than like taking any time at all to like appreciate that you've made that achievement, they're already like shifting to, well, okay, this is cool, but I'll be happy now when I get to this next thing. So that there's never actually like a point in time in which they're just kind of basking in the accomplishments that they've.
You know what? Have you ever, you know who Mr. Beast is? You guys know who Mr. Beast is?
Who's Mr. Beast? Do you know Mr. Beast?
So he's this super huge YouTuber. My kids watch him. I thought he was just that kind of guy. Like, the last person to take their hand off the Ferrari wins the Ferrari, or we bought an island and the last person to leave the island. He does these ridiculous wild things, and he's like the top YouTuber out there. Okay. And he did a podcast the other day. I think it was Joe Rogan. And
Mr. Beast,
he's super famous. He's very he should be very wealthy. I'll say it that way. But he reinvests all of the money that he gets from this stuff back into making videos. And when he was asked why, it was because he loved what he was doing. And he said, so I think the question came like, what kind of car do you drive? And he said, I have one Tesla. And I have one Tesla because I'm trying to get off of gasoline, because he's got a lot of nonprofits and he's very earth conscious and things like that. And I was like, that's cool. And then, so you must live in this giant house. And he goes, oh no, a year ago, I left the townhome that me and my buddy were living in and splitting rent for $350 bucks a month. And they're like, you have a $10 million facility that you built to make videos. You have all this money and stuff. And it's like, why didn't that change who you are? And he said, you know, he goes, first, my philanthropic efforts. He goes, if I'm living in a mansion while feeding the homeless, he goes, there's something hypocritical about that. And I was like, okay. And so now my respect for Mr. Beast is now becoming like, this dude's a genius.
Yeah.
It's not just some guy that annoys me on the TV when my kids are watching it. And then he goes, he said, if you live your life constantly trying to have a nicer box to drive or a nicer box that you live in, you're never going to fulfill your life. He goes, I don't care. He goes, I only moved because we got robbed and all of the stuff that I had got stolen. He goes, a little bit more security. I live in a suburb in North Carolina in a moderate house. He goes, that's where it is. That's what I want to do. He goes, I'd much rather do this and help other people in this and that. And I was like, man, Mr. Beast is not the guy I thought he was. You know, he's not the thing. And the amount of effort he put into his job in order to become the success that he is hundreds of thousands of hours of just boring work that he did. How does this thumbnail on YouTube reflect views? And they would look at thousands and thousands and data, collect it and this and that until he figured out the algorithm on his own. And it was just amazing to listen to and hear his perspective and those little nuggets. If you're constantly trying to upgrade the box you drive to work, your life is probably pretty crappy. And I was like, yeah. Yes, this guy's got it.
That's refreshing. I think you were one of the first people, because I went from public education into the nonprofit space. And I think I had a lot of naive notions about nonprofit and like, not that they're all like sketchy or anything like that. There's just like, there's elements of the nonprofit world that are a little odd. And I remember the first time you were talking to me about, like, I think it was like Goodwill or Salvation Army or something, how like almost 80% of the money going through that organization was being spent on like really expensive like salaries for executives that.
Oh, this Wounded Warrior Project back in the day.
Okay. Terrible. Yeah. I couldn't remember exactly specifically because we were just kind of like chopping it up and talking about like real stuff. And I've learned a lot from you as a result. And just like when there is an organization that is kind of entrepreneurial and cause based, there's a lot of weird gray area. And that's why it's important to like research charities at bare minimum. There's websites you can kind of like go to that tell you if there's anything kind of sketchy about a given organization, because there's like large cancer organizations like Susan B. Komen and stuff that like a lot of their money could be
like 15 cents of your dollar goes to actual research. Well, yeah,
it could be helping a lot more people as well. Yep. Instead they're spending millions of dollars on a gala once a year to wine and dine their largest funders and stuff like that. And having those conversations with you was really eye-opening because you had an experience with Wounded Warrior, and
I've had a couple now.
I think that's important to have people out there that like fight for those pieces of the issue. Like,
so I think a big part of it too is when I started like readjusting my life, not this last year, but the first time around, I went back to school. I got my MBA, and then I was in business school, but I had a big focus on like nonprofit because I'd started my own nonprofit at once. Uh-huh. And was kind of just led in this direction, and people wanted me here, but nobody was really kind of supporting the mission. And I wasn't really being listened to. And so I buried that, moved on to this other nonprofit. Things like that happen. And I think you have to put your time in. So the people have to get paid if that nonprofit is going to move, you know. But if you're in a nonprofit scape to become wealthy, that's the wrong move. I think a lot of these nonprofits get in, they become complacent, they need more funding, this and that. And then the mission starts going to the back of their mind. So like, here's our mission, here's our motto, this is what we're trying to do. But I think that starts to get lost and clouded and confused a little bit. And then how many donors and this and that starts to becoming the mission within the internal structure of the nonprofit. And like Wounded Warrior Project, for that instance, it starts, when that stuff starts becoming publicly available, you start losing more and more and more. And like Wounded Warrior Project's a great organization. They 180'd hard. They're killing it right now and they're doing great stuff. But separating nonprofit from the sketchy business world that we all are succumbing to essentially right now. Why is gas so high when price for a barrel of oil is actually lower? That, you know what I'm saying? There's some price stuff issues going on there. But nonprofits are businesses. You can't separate them. That's what they are. They're part of the business world. They're part of the business structure. That's how they operate. And I found that in the business world, more often than not, you're kind of a number. You're just a number. They can replace you. They can move you to somewhere else. They can get rid of you. They can do what they want. That's how it works. And I'm not a fan of that, you know. I was recently running for office. I was going to run for my district's seat. And I went to three little rallies that were made for me. And I quickly realized, like, oh, you want me to become something that I'm not. I came here to do X, Y, Z, but you want me here to be a part of this because I'm a veteran and I was wounded. And now that story becomes valuable to you, the other people around me. And that wasn't what I wanted. So I told him to kick rocks after the third one. And I never heard from him again. You know, I was like, oh, I'm done doing this. I don't want to be a part of this. This isn't going to work. Cause they weren't listening to what I was trying to change. They were trying to utilize me for an agenda that wasn't part of my agenda. And I wasn't cool with it. I learned to stand up for myself over these past few years as well. Like, hey, not everybody's a good person and that's fine. But you don't have to hang out with the good people. They don't have to. And that crosses into your families and everything. I've cut off people very, very close, family members and things like that. But just because we share the same blood and DNA and this and that doesn't make you a good person. And I don't have to agree with your weird ways. If you don't want to learn and educate yourself and see perspective from other angles and teach yourself how to incorporate that stuff into your thinking, I'm not big on you. I don't really need you around. I don't need you around my kids. I've had older adults who are real close family members say some off-colored, it's racism is what it is. I'm not even going to try and sugarcoat it. Some racist stuff around my kids. And I'm like, oh, you're out. We don't talk like that. I don't want that around my kids. That's clouding the way it's systematic. That's systematic racism right there. And you aren't going to teach my kids that because I'm trying to tear that shit down in my own home. And it hurts a little bit, but at the same time, you kind of feel good, you know, like, hey, I'm not trying to silence this person or anything crazy like that, but those are my kids and I get to kind of control what's being said around them and said, especially by people who are supposed to be influential in their lives, you know?
Yeah. And when is it a waste of your time and energy and not necessary?
Yep. Yeah, the most difficult thing for some people to do, especially with like close friends and family. And I think that's why this idea of Mr. Beast and his approach to what he is doing, that's got me really compelled. I think that's really dope because it reminds me of just like how like genuine you've been about your experience and standing up for yourself when stuff seems like they're trying to take advantage of you and your story and tokenize what has been a very challenging experience in your life. So it's really cool that there's people like Mr. Beast out there that like kind of represent like a different way to do it, different way to be about it. And yeah, man, I've seen you like pour out feelings, you know, by telling your story, but I've also seen your artwork too. Did you find some peace in being able to go and paint and stuff during the past couple of years?
A little bit. I've kind of channeled it more into doing activities with my kids, you know, that type of stuff. Nice. Having them paint some stuff and then talking a little bit about that. My older son, he brings home like stuff from school and I'm like, you did this? And he said, yeah. And I'm like, this is good. Like, this is really good. Like that. So I have this notion, like if whatever they're doing, whether it be painting or sports or things like that, if my kids come home with a sports medal, it's going to replace a medal that I have on my wall. One of my medals, you know, kind of passing the torch. That's kind of how I look at it. So if they come home and there's a drawing that they're really interested in, one of my paintings is going into a storage somewhere. And that's the painting that's now going to be represented and displayed in my home. And they don't understand why I'm doing it yet. It's the long-term type of thing, you know? Like, I don't want any of my accomplishments to be displayed in my home. I don't want them. I've done them. I know what they are. I've seen them. We've talked about it. It happened, you know? But I'm passing that torch on to these little guys, you know? So when they have something that they're really proud of or this and that, I take something that I was really proud of and I'm still proud of, but it doesn't need to be displayed anymore. We're going to display this thing to raise them up, you know?
Yeah. Cool, dude.
It's a cool little concept to see and witness, you know? I still hold on to some stuff. Like I said, I was on SportsCenter twice. So when my kid brings his participation medal home from rec league basketball, I'm like, hey, that's cool. But have you ever been on SportsCenter? And he's like, no. And I'm like, you got some work to do, my dude. You know? Like, I kind of throw it at him, you know, just keep him motivated at the same time. But
yeah,
celebrate but everything. Like you're,
yeah, but by doing that, what you were saying, like, you know, replacing some of the stuff with their pride, it's like you're not, I think a lot of parents get in this trap of like, trying to mold their kids into something that they would rather want, you know, that they want, and pushing their wants onto their kids, you know? And so I think like accepting them for who they are and what they're proud of is huge.
Dope. I think that's a big thing too, is like, I'm not trying to make cookie cutters. I'm trying to make citizens who are going to change the world and set the example, you know. And my kids coming along to a lot of my events when I was doing the sporting and stuff, they were raised around service members who were disfigured and lost limbs and burned over 90. So they don't see that stuff like I saw it when I was a kid. Or if I saw somebody extremely burned, it was scary, made you feel weird. And you'd ask questions and stuff like that. And so it was cool to see, like, my kids start learning that that's just something that happened. They were, it was out of their control. But now if we go out in public and they see, like, a child who's got, like, Down syndrome or some sort of condition, or they're acting differently than the norm, they're like, oh, he's got something he can't control. Just like I've got, like my oldest son, just like I've got this thing that I can't control, and like you can't control your leg and this and that. So it's cool to see them make those connections, but treat them like just normal people. Just that's how it should be, you know? And people, I've been asked so many, what if your son, this was a big one in the military, what if your son's gay? And like, I don't care. Like, well, what do you mean? Isn't that going to make you angry? I said, no. I said, the same rules are going to apply. If you have your significant other in my home, the door's open because I want to make sure everybody's safe. I said, the only thing that changes is if my son has questions about picking dudes up, he's going to have to ask his mom because I don't know how to do that. And that's he's going to get better information from her. Now, what if do you want your kids to join the military? I don't care. Honestly, I don't want them to. But if they choose to, I'm going to support it. But if they don't want to, I don't care. Like it's
they're their own people.
Yeah, choose your path, man. Go the route you want to go. They like video games. I play video games. I got a Twitch channel and I've streamed and stuff like that. And so they play a lot of video games. I can't play video games for the hours and hours these dudes play video games for. It drives me insane, you know. But I'll support that, but I want to make sure they know too, like that's not the real world. Like that's a video game. You get to control the outcome and you get to try again and this and that. But as long as we keep those distinctions separate, you know, we aren't going to get super, super emotional and throw our video game controller because we're so upset. We need to talk about those feelings and find a better route. Cause I don't know how many PlayStation and Xbox controllers I've had to replace over the last couple of years with these dudes. But, it started to get a little out of hand, so we're making sure we take breaks and things like that, you know.
Hell yeah. What game do you play? What games do you like to play?
Right now I'm playing Red Dead Redemption 2 when I get a chance. Super fun. I streamed it a couple times. I'm in a whitelist server for Grand Theft Auto Online, and you RP as a character. It's one of the wildest things I've ever seen in a video game, but it's super fun. Like my character's a dispatcher for the police officer, so that's his job. So I literally go log on to this video game and I have a job. Like I have to go in and dispatch and direct police to things and deal with customers that come or civilians that come in. And it's a lot of fun. If you've never seen GTA RP, it's super cool to see. But I'm in this server. It's whitelisted. You have to go through an application process, and there's all these rules that you got to follow, and you got to make it like real life, like as immersive as you can. And there's gang members and street racers and all the other GTA stuff you see out there. But there's also people who play civilians who don't want to be involved in crime and law abide and all this stuff. So like I was speeding in my sports car the other day and I got pulled over, and police officer was a hard ass police officer getting on me, and it was cool. Like, because it's another person. There's like 200 people on the server playing the character, so
I've never
your interaction heard of change.
This kind of it's like metaverse type stuff.
It's pretty fun. It's a lot of it's interesting. But you have to play your character.
I bet those whitelist server kind of situations could be so different, or like so transformative for gaming. As far as like if you wanted to create like safer gaming spaces without like bunch of randoms that are just going to talk shit and make people feel bad. Because a lot of
they
times
have the same problems. They have the same problems though that like a lot of like businesses and stuff have is some of these people this is their job. Like their real life job is to make money off of Twitch, you know,
or
Facebook gaming or YouTube. And so sometimes that affects the gameplay. It's not a game anymore. Now it's a job, you know? And so it's weird to see that dynamic, but I watch some people who pulling hundreds of thousands and millions of dollars playing video games for a living. So when I look at my kids and they're throwing a fit about a video game and I want to be like, you'll never get anywhere playing video game. Like, these dudes are loaded and they're living their life.
Like, I don't know.
I'm like, so maybe that's not a good example anymore. You know,
we have that's like it makes me think of like a old school traditional dad being like, podcast, what the fuck is that? You're never gonna make a living as a podcaster. And then like 5 years later, like their kid is just like
killing it.
Yeah, just
that's what they're doing.
Like a radio broadcast star, pretty much.
But we have to accept that as adults. Like when I was a kid and my dad was like, you'd never get anywhere playing video games, he was right. Like there was no platform to do something like that. But now that exists, and that goes into all aspects of our life, race, religion, sexuality, all those things, it's all changing. And you could put a hard stop that I don't like change and I don't want it to affect me and I'm not going to allow it to happen. And that's fine. You can live your life that way, but this is still going to happen. This is still happening in the world. And you can educate yourself about it and alter your thinking if you want to. But you have that option. That's the thing people sometimes forget is like, that's cool that you want to, this is how it's supposed to be and blah, blah, blah. But that's not the reality of the situation. You can't change it. You're just one person. That's not how it works. And why stifle other people for doing what they want to do?
Yeah.
Back to Mr. Beast. He's been doing YouTube since he's 11. When he graduated high school, his mom said, you can go to college and live in my home, or you can get out and get a new job or get a job. So he pretended he went to college and sat in his car for 15 hours a day and made videos. And then eventually one of his videos, 1 month, he made $20,000. So he told his mom, hey, I've never stepped foot in the college that I'm enrolled in. The reports are going to be zeros because I didn't go in. But hey, I made it here. And now fast forward 10 years later and millions and millions of dollars for these videos, you know, it's just how it is. That's
and
how
this
things
is why
work.
You accept your kids for who they are.
Yeah,
right on.
They'll make you look like
let them be what they want to be.
Yeah,
make sure they're safe, you know. Yeah. That's my number one concern. As long as you're safe, I don't care. You want to skate, let's skate. You want a video game, go ahead. You want to my youngest child's got different colored hair every other week. I don't know what color his hair is going to be when I pick him up from school, because I think he's got blue right now.
You got a little blue going on.
I'm like, do it, because I can't dye my hair and go to my corporate gig. That's not going to work out for me. So do it now while you can before life catches up, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, maybe by the time they're in corporate, it'll be all good too. The way things are changing.
Yeah.
Man, time flies. A conversation like this. So we didn't get to talk about a few things that I wanted to talk about, but maybe you'll be able to come back on again sometime.
I'm ready.
That'd be awesome, man. Because we didn't get a chance to talk about the digital art that you were doing with the Pokemon transformations.
Oh yeah.
We didn't get to talk about like some of your favorite concert experiences, because I know you've got some pretty amazing ones, and like maybe how it's been different now that your dad bringing your guys with you. But you know, maybe we'll get into that on a future episode, man. It's been amazing to catch up a little bit. And, you know, we just can't thank you enough for bringing what you brought to the Tomorrow Show.
Yeah.
No, I appreciate it. This was a good step back into it. And I'd love to come back for sure. Start being a little more involved, you know.
Awesome.
Before we get out of here, is Dobby still in the room?
No, Tallulah's in here, the other one.
Tallulah, because Pets were like kind of where we started the show today, talking about Phoenix. The rescue, and I know you've rescued quite a few pups yourself. Hi, Tallulah, what's up, baby?
Yeah, we have four dogs, two cats, a guinea pig now, and a chameleon.
Oh, cool!
Man.
We have a farm. We're actually watching my dad and mother-in-law's puppy too, so he's here.
You got a menagerie, man.
Awesome. Oh, yeah.
Look at those ears.
Oh, yeah, man. Well, we'll have to come visit you soon before you move on to your new castle in September.
Yeah.
And then you got to come then, too, though.
Yeah, we'll come then, too. But we'll bring our board when we drive out your way. Maybe skate over to the skate park.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Practice. Well, say hi to your family. I know I speak for Aaron and AC that this was awesome. And we can't wait to kind of do this again with y'all in the future. Thank you all the commenters, all the Twitch streamers that have been cheering bits, and
yeah,
thanks for the subs and all that. It's a really amazing thing. And we're just starting too. So support the Hope for Us Network, share them on your socials, follow them on TikTok and YouTube and all the places. And then in 2 weeks, we're going to be back with another installment of the Tomorrow Show. So, yeah. Oh, and a big shout out to the Fish Cam and our friendly fish, Gara, our man Scott's pet fish. And Scott, as always, man, thanks for pulling up cool things to keep this broadcast rolling along. We'll keep doing it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Please like and subscribe and give us feedback.
Yeah. Watch the Oscars tonight if you're into films, and you know, enjoy your evening. And we're going to be in April next time we see you. So happy spring.
Yes.
Happy spring. And before we go today,
shout out to Taylor Hawkins. Rest in peace, dude.
Yeah.
You will be missed. You will be missed.
Do you have a favorite Foo Fighters song, Ryan?
Oh man. Everlong. There's something about that song. I don't know. I think it's the drums, honestly, and that's fitting for this, but man, Everlong, I can throw that on at any time and it changes the mood.
You know, a friend of mine was lucky enough to win a contest, so they got to go to Lollapalooza in Argentina. And Foo Fighters, the last song of their set, and this would turn out to be Taylor's last show, was their encore Everlong. So it's pretty pretty wild that that's what you said of all the Foo Fighters songs. And she posted a video of it this morning, just like kind of with a shocked caption that, like, while she was taking it, she had no idea that it would be, you know, the last performance that Taylor would give. But as you can see, the internet really through the internet, you can see that this guy was one of those people that always made people feel special. No matter how much fame, how much notoriety, he always made people feel special. He was full of smiles and compliments and just great vibes. So I'm sorry to everybody that's hurting out there in the music world, grieving the loss of just a monumental drummer. I didn't know until me and AC were hanging out the other night when got the news that he got his start playing in Alanis Morissette's band. Yeah.
Yep.
He was on the Jagged Little Pill release and tour, and then Dave saw him and was like,
Dave scooped him.
Yeah, they saw him over time in passing, like festivals here and there, shows. And one day, Alanis was like, so what are you going to do? And Taylor was like, what do you mean, what am I going to do? And just like, when Dave asked you to join his band, because she just saw how they connected whenever, you know, they passing, you know, just saw the vibe. He's like, dude, whatever. Like, it's Dave Grohl, Nirvana. He's got his own thing. It's never going to happen. And I guess that tour ended, or that festival show overseas or whatever. And then, like, a few weeks later, called him up. It's like, hey, would you be down to lay some tracks on this record? He was like, yeah. I guess the other drummer wasn't cutting it or whatever. Here we are.
That was it.
That's it.
50 years old, gone far too soon. And so hug your people, tell them you love them, because nothing's guaranteed in this life. But you keep on finding things that help you get through to tomorrow. be it art, be it music, be it your kids and your pets and all that. So love each other. And until we see you in a couple weeks,